When you hear the name Stephen King, what's the first thing that comes to mind? Surely words such as horror, evil, and terror are a few buzzwords to consider. But what location comes to mind? Some will think of the Poor Losers Club living it up in Derry. Others may call to mind Paul Sheldon, writing away in Bangor. But for me, my mind always goes to the Overlook Hotel and its real-life inspiration. Hey kids, welcome home. Today we continue our virtual road trip around the United States, learning more about the most reportedly haunted locations that exist among us. And without being too sus, we're going to take a look into the lore of the Stanley Hotel, which was the inspiration for one of Stephen King's most popular novels, The Shining. We will discuss the history of the hotel and explore some of the investigations and reports that have occurred over the years, including King's own experiences. So sit back, plug in your nightlight, and prepare for a spooky time, because you know what happens to those who don't behave.
Perhaps they need a good talking to, if you don't mind my saying so. Perhaps a bit more. But I corrected them, sir. And when my wife tried to prevent me from doing my duty, I corrected her.
The Stanley Hotel sits on 8 acres of land in Estes Park, Colorado, over an enormous underground cave system that boasts more than 400 rooms and over 14,000 square feet of meeting and event space. The history of the hotel dates back to 1903, when inventor Freeland Oscar, F.O. Stanley, first arrived in Colorado upon the direction of his doctor, weak and underweight, suffering from consumption. Joined by his wife Flora, they were immediately charmed by the area, and Stanley found himself revitalized by the mountain air after just a single season, and vowed that he would return every summer for the rest of his life. Due in part to the fact that he and Flora were more accustomed to the lavish and sophisticated lifestyle that they enjoyed living on the East Coast, Stanley teamed up with Burton Sanborn to purchase the 6,000-acre Dunraven Ranch from the Estes Park Development Company with the intent to build a lush and opulent hotel, which he did. Stanley Hotel officially opened its doors on July 4th of 1909. The buildings were designed by T. Robert Wagar, with direct influence by Stanley himself, as he fancied himself as somewhat of an architect. The Stanley Hotel was built as a resort for upper-class Easterners and a health retreat for those suffering from pulmonary tuberculosis. Later in 1909, a separate concert hall was designed with the assistance of architect Henry Rogers, fashioning it after the Boston Symphony Hall. Freeland Stanley wanted the concert hall to serve as a gift to wife Flora, who was suffering from failing eyesight, but who had in her day been an avid piano player. Later on, a smaller hotel called the Stanley Manor was constructed and was housed between the main building and concert hall, serving as a year-round resort, fully heated for use in winter months. The manor is still in use today, although it is now called the Lodge and serves as a bed and breakfast. The Stanley Hotel and its surrounding structures are listed on the National Register of Historic Places, and is a member of the Historic Hotels of America and the National Trust for Historic Preservation. A fair portion of the interest that continues to surround the Stanley Hotel can be accredited to Stephen King and his experiences with his wife Tabitha in 1974. The pair checked into the Stanley Hotel in late October and, in a direct reflection of the book and subsequent film, King and his wife were the only guests in residence that night, as the hotel was in its last few days before closing for the winter season. They were alone, with a small skeleton crew of hotel staff. King was enthralled by the massive abandoned hallways, eating in an otherwise empty dining room, and having a lengthy conversation with the bartender. Further inspiration to be later found in the novel and book, maybe? King was intrigued by the overall creepy effect of being alone in an environment that is usually brimming with activity and the sounds of people. Not that he felt alone. King recalls that his sleep that night was anything but peaceful, having a dream involving his son, Joe Hill, who would himself grow up to be quite the renowned horror writer. The dream was said to be terrifying, as King would be the unwilling audience to his son being chased through the many hallways of the Stanley Hotel, chased by a possessed fire hose. King, awakening in a cold sweat, stepped out of the room onto the balcony for a cigarette to calm his nerves. And by the time he returned to bed beside his wife, the details and events of The Shining were all but complete in his head. With all of the guests that have been flocked to the hotel over the subsequent years, there has been much debate into the fact that maybe there was more to this than a mere dream, and was instead the workings of the reported ghosts that are said to haunt the room in which he stayed. And if you've read the book, I'm sure you can imagine just what room that was. In King's own words, it was a perfectly ordinary door, no different from any other door on the first floors of the hotel. It was dark gray, halfway down a corridor that ran at right angles to the main second-floor hallway. The numbers on the door looked no different from the house numbers on their Boulder apartment that they lived in. A 2, a 1, and a 7. But more on that in a bit.
As we take a look at the other reported sightings, sensations, and evidence of paranormal events surrounding the Stanley Hotel, it is important to note that the reports come not just from investigators with television shows and ratings to consider. Many of the cases of paranormal activity come from well-respected individuals, average tourists, and those who would simply have nothing to gain by fanning the flame of a potential haunting. The Stanley Hotel has seen its fair share of well-known and famous guests, including the unsinkable Molly Brown, infamous Titanic survivor, John Philip Sousa, Theodore Roosevelt, the Emperor and Empress of Japan, of course, Stephen King himself, and the cast and crew of the film Dumb and Dumber, as many scenes of the film were shot in and around the Stanley Hotel. The Stanley Hotel has reportedly also hosted its fair share of otherworldly guests. The most notable is F.O. Stanley himself, who's reportedly seen frequently in the lobby and billiard room, a favorite of his before his death, and apparently remains so even after. Apparently, he likes to make his presence known during tours of the hotel, as he will frequently randomly appear standing behind tour guests. Several bartenders over the years have also reported that Freeland will materialize behind the bar, only to disappear when they attempt to intercept him as he moves toward the kitchen. Apparently, Freeland's wife remains active in her afterlife, as the sounds of her piano playing can be faintly heard by hotel guests long into the evening. Employees of the hotel will be summoned to investigate the noise, and upon entering the ballroom, the claims are that the piano keys are still moving. However, upon hearing the footsteps entering the room, the noises immediately cease, and the keys become still. There are several rooms that have reported paranormal occurrences over the years, and as we've already discussed, Stephen King's experience in room 217, we will start there. Although the room number would be changed to 237 for the film, many people, to this day, request to stay in the room made infamous by the book, so much so that according to TripAdvisor, it is recommended that you book the room several months in advance. In fact, upon the recording of this video in March of 2021, the room is booked until July 13th. And if you are the curious type and are brave enough to stay the night, the room rate is $300 a night. However, for those that do stay, many later regret it. Room 217 boasts the appeal of a full library of Stephen King novels and several instances of eerie experiences. The haunting of Room 217 seems to have originated back in 1911 when the hotel's head housekeeper at the time, Elizabeth Wilson, now lovingly referred to as Mrs. Wilson, went from room to room lighting the many gas lamps during a raging storm. When Mrs. Wilson arrived in room 217, the gas leaked, causing an explosion that blew the room apart, and Mrs. Wilson's body was flung back and landed one floor down. Miraculously, she survived with just a few broken bones and did in fact return to the hotel to work several more years before later retiring. Mrs. Wilson was so beloved that she was given a forever position as a staff member, a role to this day that she takes very seriously. Guests of the room will claim that they will return to their rooms to find their luggage has been all unpacked and that their shoes have been neatly lined up and clothes hung neatly. Although Mrs. Wilson is quite old-fashioned and seems to disapprove of unmarried couples sharing the room's bed and will create a cold draft in the night between the pair. Several guests offer reports of seeing shadows moving through the walls and believe this to be Elizabeth moving from room to room to complete her work. It is reported that Jim Carrey himself was booked to stay in room 217 while filming Dumb and Dumber with co-star Jeff Daniels back in 1994. And he has to be moved after 3 short hours. To this day, Carey refuses to comment on what occurred in that room and what had him so spooked he felt that he couldn't stay a minute more. Another room that is said to have some haunted activity is room 401. Reportedly, the room is haunted by Lord Dunraven, the gentleman who owned the acreage the hotel sits upon prior to Stanley's purchase. According to one hotel guest, the lights in the corner of the room near the bathroom would repeatedly turn off and on. At one point, aggravated, the guest called out to Lord Dunraven, informing him that he was aware the Lord was in the room, and informed him that he would only be staying for 2 nights, and then would leave the room to him, and asked him kindly to turn the light back on, to which Lord Dunraven graciously obliged. Staff over the years claim that the image of a man can be seen from the grounds standing in the window of room 401, even when the room is vacant. There seems to be quite a bit of reports involving the spirits of children that are prevalent in the hallways, and most importantly in room 418. Cleaning crews report having heard many noises coming from the room, as well as seeing impressions on the bed when the bed has been empty. When guests stay in the room, they often report that they hear children playing in the halls at night, lights flickering, hangers moving of their own accord, and covers being ripped off in the middle of the night. One couple reportedly checked out of the hotel very early in the morning, complaining that the children in the hallway had kept them up all night. However, there were no children booked in the hotel at the time. Room 428 is said to be haunted by the spirit of a chivalrous cowboy who reportedly frequents the room in the dead of night. Many female hotel guests have reported being awoken to the sounds of footsteps in the room, and they are met with the image of a cowboy pacing back and forth across the room. And upon realizing that the cowboy is completely see-through, the cowboy is said to kiss the female guest on the forehead, turn, and leave the room. Another room with ghostly claims is room 412, which has been dubbed the Poltergeist Room, due to the terrifying events often reported here. One guest of the hotel claims to have been awoken in the middle of the night to find the bed levitating. The woman was so distraught, she went into a full panic mode, so much so that she had to be removed from the premises by police escort. The hotel seems to revel in its reputation as the Disneyland for ghosts, and while they do offer a hotel tour that focuses on the history of the hotel, NFO, and flora, by far and away the most popular offering of the hotel is its night tour, which leans a little more heavily into the supernatural lane. The hotel even employs their own resident psychic named Madame Vera, and once offered a 5-hour guided ghost tour with staff paranormal investigator Lisa Neihart. The hotel includes a guest package referred to as the Ghost Adventure Package, and those who opt for this experience are assigned a room on the infamous fourth floor and are provided with a small, pocket-sized electromagnetic field reader and a coffee mug with the infamous Red Rum written across its front. The hotel sits on a foundation of quartz and limestone, which is said to be a conductor for supernatural activity. So it isn't really much of a surprise that tales of hauntings and eerie occurrences persist to this day, which leads to many ghost hunting teams seeking out the Stanley Hotel to conduct investigations. One of the first of these teams would be TAPS, the Atlantic Paranormal Society. The TAPS team would check in February of 2006 and definitely had some interesting experiences. The most noteworthy of these, at least in my opinion, comes as TAPS co-founder Jason J. Hawes tries to get some sleep in room 401. However, it would seem that Lord Dunraven had different plans for Jay.
officer. I'm not sure what happened. I heard the closet open. Turn on the light for you guys. Closet door is open. This glass actually broke. Here's a piece. And this. Guess I won't be drinking on that one anytime soon. Leaving it right here for you guys. Enjoy. All right, guys. Glass already broke. Closet door opened. I'm gonna put the camera on the table next to me. So you guys know. All right.
The TAPS team would become so enamored with the hotel that they would return later that year for a six-hour live Halloween investigation. From random cold spots and faint piano playing coming from an empty concert hall, the personal experiences that night were pretty off the charts. But it would be when Jay would team up with fellow TAPS co-founder Grant Wilson in the Quartz and Limestone Underground employee passages in the tunnels to investigate alone that they would realize that assuming they were alone maybe wasn't so accurate.
How far back does it go, G?
You hear that?
I heard that.
Jay and I were down the employee passageway, and we started hearing a voice. We heard a hello, like a female hello.
Hello?
Are you hearing the voices?
Yeah.
Just said hello. Hello.
Yeah, I heard it.
Who are you?
Shh. There it is again.
I got it on audio.
You do?
You want to see if I can hear it?
Yeah.
Listen. Holy.
As we said hello and we tried to communicate back, it said other things that we really need to analyze and see what it did say.
Oh my gosh, what is going on?
There was a laugh.
And then what sounded like some creepy laughter. And it was from right around us. It didn't sound like it was coming from out in the hallway or above us. It sounded like it was like right in there.
Yeah, but how could it be?
Well. And we instantly ran out there and tried to look both ways, and there's no one else down here. It's just us and a cameraman. I just heard it again.
This basement's a pretty wild area.
What has baffled most people in regards to this piece of evidence is how clearly the girl's voice can be heard in real time and also captured on their recording devices. And we couldn't look into TV ghost hunting teams without mentioning the Travel Channel cult hit Ghost Adventures. So for our last look into professional investigations that have taken place at the Stanley Hotel, we dive into a season 4 episode recorded in October of 2010. Zach Bagans, Aaron Goodwin, and former investigator Nick Groff found themselves at the historic hotel for their own little investigation.
Here's Zach!
After conducting their standard interviews with hotel staff, the trio opted to sleep in three separate rooms with known activity to see if the ghosts would come out and play. And did they ever? Zach opted to spend the night in room 401, Lord Dunraven's room, and from the moment he entered the room, he stated that he felt chills and that the room made him uncomfortable. At 3 a.m., often referred to as the witching hour, Zach captures some interesting evidence.
At 3 a.m., I was woken up by an unexplained noise, and shortly after that, my digital recorder captured an EVP.
Who's there? Who's over there? Shut that door.
Shut this door. move something.
Just want to document. I heard someone's walking around in my room.
And for Aaron's solo investigation, he opted to jokingly don a pink wig and see if he could arouse the attention of the gentleman cowboy in room 428. Unfortunately, it seems that the ghost was less than enthused by the not-so-subtle sounds of Aaron's snoring.
Looks like Aaron had company as well. From the moment Aaron hit the bed, he didn't move a single inch. And while he was sleeping, we strongly believe that his loud snoring angered a spirit that was trying to sleep in the same bed. Here's the audio from his recorder on the nightstand. Meanwhile, back in the snoring room, it seems the spirit was now asking Aaron for something so it could leave the room.
And lastly, former Ghost Adventures investigator Nick Groff decided to brave the poltergeist room and was also able to capture some unique experiences on camera.
At 2:46 a.m., when Aaron and I were both fast asleep in our other rooms, Nick captured this EVP that sounds like a man provoking him.
See if I can capture any of the voices. All right, holding the recorder still now, not moving. Can you tell me what you're still doing in this room?
What makes this even stranger is right when the EVP is captured, you can clearly see this unexplained anomaly, which has a mist-like form that moves from right to left, directly towards Nick's digital recorder. Is this the manifestation of the spirit that's communicating?
Still now, not moving. Can you tell me what you're still doing in this room?
Feeling in here is just uneasy, like someone's staring at you the whole time as you're laying here in this bed. I definitely think there's someone or something in this room.
So, just what is it about the Stanley Hotel that has so many people still flocking to hopefully have an encounter with the ghosts of its past? I believe that not all hauntings exist because of trauma and, quote, unfinished business. Sometimes, a location is so loved and cared for by its inhabitants that they opt to remain, even in the afterlife. And although Stephen King would bring the creep factor to the residual guests that hang around the property, I believe that F.O. and Flora Stanley created a place that they were truly proud of while they were alive. True hospitality from the likes of the warm and kind Mrs. Wilson to Flora wanting to fill the space with music is proof positive that the overwhelming emotions that bind us to this place can be positive as well as negative. And what better tribute to the legacy built by Freeland than the evidence of so many of its former guests and staff opting to never check out. I want to thank each and every one of you for your patience with these uploads. I'm a one-mom show, so between research and editing, these do take a while to get out. But I really hope you're enjoying watching them as much as I enjoy making them. Please make sure to visit the links in the description and give some love to the creators that helped to make this video possible. I will be posting a link to the straw poll for the next pit stop in our haunted journey, so do make sure you stop by and vote. I also want to give a huge thank you to our subscriber shout-out, the one, the only, Rack, my favorite son-in-law. And don't let the fact that he is my only son-in-law fool you. He is truly a great person with an even greater heart. With a voice to rival D'Angelo Wallace and Corpse, all of the members of the Discord server rush to the chat channels when it's time for a Rack story time. I can't begin to tell you what your support means to me, and I am honored to call you son. As always, make sure you like the video, comment your thoughts, and do me the exceeding honor of hitting that subscribe button
and becoming a member of the Press Start family. Sweet dreams, kids. I'll see you in the next one.